professor mentor dos mais oprimidos, alunos com valores, ético crítico, criador da escola do saber sobre o poder. Que o mundo moderno não mate os nossos sonhos, questiona sempre, inclusive os freirianos, tudo de ciência, humanismo, dentro e fora da sala de aula, aprender emana reflexão da complexidade humana. Paulo cristão, a base do pensamento racional. Ensino é um ato político Paulo Freire é educação. Pensar transforma, muda, é abolição. Freiriana é sua missão. Pensar transforma, muda, é evolução. O conhecimento liberta, vamos transformar. Educar o mundo de dentro pra fora interpretar. Mundo líquido, monolítico. A solução é alfabetizar, é reinventar. Me dê a mão e vamos para a luta já. Braços abertos à felicidade encontrar. De braços dados vamos ao outro ajudar. Paulo, pernambucano, franzino, valente, homem de bem, revolucionário, pensador. Além do seu tempo, destemido como um futuro visionário. Você sim merece uma estátua, meu rapaz. Herói nacional, defensor da cultura e paz. Foi traído, perseguido, seus ideais foram oprimidos e subjugados. Portanto, o amor ao próximo, Paulo foi exilado. Plantou a semente com amor e dedicação. Com métodos da primária pós-graduação. Mais oprimidos, alunos com valores ético-crítico, criador da escola do saber sobre o poder. Que o mundo moderno não mate os nossos sonhos. Questiona sempre, inclusive os freirianos, tudo de ciência. Fora da sala de aula, aprender emana reflexão da complexidade humana. Paulo cristão, a base do pensamento racional. Ensino é um ato político cultural. Pensar transforma, muda, é abolição. Freiriana é sua missão. Pensar transforma, muda, é evolução. O conhecimento liberta, vamos transformar. Educar o mundo de dentro pra fora interpretar. Monolítico. A solução é alfabetizar, é reinventar. Me dê a mão e vamos para a luta já. Braços abertos à felicidade encontrar. De braços dados vamos ao outro ajudar. Paulo pernambucano franzino, valente homem de bem, revolucionário, pensador, além do seu tempo, destemido como um futuro visionário. Você sim merece uma estátua, meu rapaz, herói nacional, defensor da cultura e paz. Foi traído, perseguido, seus ideais foram oprimidos e subjugados. Portanto, amor ao próximo, Paulo foi exilado. Plantou a semente com amor e dedicação, com métodos da primária pós-graduação. Mais oprimidos, alunos com valores ético-crítico, criador da escola do saber sobre o poder, que o mundo moderno não mate os nossos sonhos, questiona sempre, inclusive os freirianos, dor de ciência. Ao aprender emana reflexão da complexidade humana. Paulo cristão, a base do pensamento racional, ensino é um ato político cultural. Pensar transforma, muda, é abolição. Freiriana é sua missão. Pensar transforma, muda, é evolução. O conhecimento liberta, vamos transformar. Educar o mundo de dentro pra fora, interpretar. Monolítico, a solução é alfabetizar, é reinventar. Me dê a mão e vamos para a luta já. Braços abertos à felicidade encontrar. De braços dados vamos ao outro ajudar. Paulo, pernambucano franzino, valente homem de bem, revolucionário, pensador, além do seu tempo, destemido como um futuro visionário. Você sim merece uma estátua, meu rapaz, herói nacional, defensor da cultura e paz. Traído, perseguido, seus ideais foram oprimidos e subjugados. Portanto, amor ao próximo, Paulo foi exilado. Plantou a semente com amor e dedicação, com métodos da primária pós-graduação. Thank you. mais oprimidos, alunos com valores ético-crítico, criador da escola do saber sobre o poder. Que o mundo moderno não mate os nossos sonhos, questiona sempre, inclusive os freirianos. Tudo de ciência, humanismo, dentro e fora da sala de aula, aprender emana reflexão da complexidade humana. Paulo cristão, a base do pensamento racional. Ensino é um ato político cultural.
Hi, my name is Kimberly Waller. I'm delighted to be able to have the opportunity to share with our audience the 9th installment of our Year of Education series. The Year of Education series was designed to give the general public, academics, scholars, street scholars, everyone who has an ear to listen, a opportunity to know more about Paulo Freire, who we know is one of the people that is the key person actually for liberatory education. The belief that the community is the place where education should be seated, should be grown, and that through words, through actions, through education, clearly the most important democratic institution in terms of the civic engagement that we have in our country and around the world, it's an opportunity for us to liberate ourselves, liberate our minds, and that of course will liberate our entire community. So thank you for joining us this evening. My name is Kimberly Waller. I'm a member of the Year of Education team. And more than anything else, I'm a teacher. And say hello to all of the students, past, present, and future. And to my colleagues, Michael Jibari Tidmore will be joining us this evening. And Michael Jibari, as we call them, is actually born and raised in the area that he loves and that he's done much of his good work in, which is the South Side of Chicago. Jibari is known as a community activist, a community leader, whose main, one of his main focuses is how to keep the peace, how to enhance the cultural heritage and the rich wealth, cultural wealth that's within the South Side of Chicago. So we appreciate the areas in which we call home. And his current mission is, of course, with Team Inglewood, where he helps lead Safe Passage and does a lot in terms of restorative justice. So thank you for being a part of the program this evening, Jibari, and also for being a colleague in the struggle, a brother in the struggle. And a sister that I have the pleasure of introducing this evening is Takia Tizzi Green. Miss Green started her career with Lionsgate, and she quickly shifted over to being a production assistant on the Gregory Hines show, Rest in Power, Gregory Hines. And from there, she just blazed her own trail. She went on to work on a number of other TV shows, and her seminal work we'll be able to see this evening, or one of them, which is WORD WARRIORS 3. And we have the opportunity to talk with her more about what the meaning is behind the Earth's double meanings, triple meanings are behind the title of her film. One thing that's amazing about her, she not only wrote and produced the film, but she also wrote and produced its theme song, Wake Up. She narrated the film in verse, and she's going to be telling us a little bit more about her concept behind the film, what its objectives were, its struggles, and the way in which it's triumphed, and how she's going to be getting this out to the general audiences. So without further ado, I have an opportunity to introduce to some and to remind others of this amazing sister. So Takia Tizzi Green, I'll let you introduce your work.
Hi, thank you so much, Kimberly. First of all, it's an honor to be here amongst you all, and really excited to be able to screen this film tonight, WORD WARRIORS 3. Can't leave out my team. You know, I didn't get this done by myself. My producing partners, Walter Thurman the third and Laya Beth LaFlora, and my other director that directed this film with me, Jamal Joseph. This was a heart tugging, passionate film for me to do. I wanted to use poetry to tell the story of our history and our struggle in America as Black people, and especially for men. So WORD WARRIORS 3, you'll be able to, you know, get an idea of different perspectives of young men and also our elders, some of our elders, to pretty much, you know, give you their side of their struggle and what they're doing and different laws that's been passed, you know, their experiences to pretty much, you know, see how we ended up here where we are today. So that's what, you know, I really want you guys to enjoy the film and pay attention to the words, because that's what this film is about. Words are powerful, you know, we speak life and death with the word that flows off of our tongues. So that's pretty much what this film is about.
Thank you. And we'll be enjoying a little bit of commentary after the film, and see you soon.
Heading up to the code 3 chase. Suspect was last reported southbound on Highway 99.
Closing fast on a vehicle that matches the description.
The educational system into which they are thrust expels them at a rate 2.5 times greater than their white peers. So you in school and you get kicked out for stuff that your white peers don't. Not only that, they are subject to detention and also put in special education programs that target them specifically as being less capable intellectually.
The miseducation is on purpose. It's not because the schools are poor. It's not because the teachers are uncertified. It's not because the mothers are unmarried. And it's not because the boys' pants are sagging. It is by design that the schools fail. And why must the schools fail by design? Because education is the most revolutionary process in any society. if it is done right, you automatically transform the oppressed. Are y'all following me?
Yes, sir.
If education is done right, you transform the oppressed into an empowered individual who now has the capability to take authority from his oppressor.
The disproportionate number of black males who are put in the criminal justice system suggests to us that there is a targeting of African American men.
The police beat me up in the middle of the street for no reason, just simply because I cursed at them, because they were harassing me, and I cursed at them. Now they beat me up. Now, in reality, I couldn't shoot them. Like in my rhymes, I would say, you know what I'm saying, pow, pow, you know what I'm saying? It was a shootout, but I couldn't do that in reality. But in my rhymes, it vents that anger because I can, you know, fire back at the police and won't go to jail for life. You know what I'm
saying? Because it's
just words. Right.
They say the 60s was crazy, but the 80s was worse. Crack fucked blacks and gave birth to a curse. The moon's bright, the sky's misty. Know my future because I know my history. My life predicted by a gypsy. Murder she wrote at the end of the story, the streets get me. That's why I live quickly and always keep a pistol with me.
I used to think that I really needed to carry a snub-nosed special. I had a real nice gun, and it was loaded, and I used to really think that that was an important part of the revolution, and I needed to be ready. Then I realized that I was walking around with something stronger than a snub-nosed special revolver, and that was my mouth and my words.
Ghetto prisoner. Won't stop fighting until I'm free. Raising a city of fallen angels where people ain't scared to bleed. If money's the root of all evil, then greed's the seed. This ain't living. We taking cause ain't nobody giving. America's a rich man's vision, but a poor man's prison. So don't expect these politicians to give us a pot to piss in. Preacher man, stop preaching cause people ain't finna listen. Folks done lost hope and stop trying.
I am a poet. I'm not a celebrity who likes to do poetry. I am a poet.
So when I think of the term word warrior, I think that our thoughts and our words create reality.
It insinuates that, you know, you're using words as your weapons.
Words always fascinated me and the way different people use them.
Be conscious of what it is that you are saying and writing. You know, it's because you people talk and it disappears, but when you write, it's there.
Life's a bitch from the start. That's why you come out your mama crying. World's dying and the people have gone mad. I take a shit on the White House and wipe my ass with the flag. How can it possibly be peace in a country built on murder? Laws passed daily, homie, to purposely hurt you. I'm the product of a hate that society nurtured. When will the evil end? Too many browns and blacks in the system, victims of legal sin. In court praying for mercy when condemned by evil men. Ain't no love in the heart of the city. If it's a God, where is he? My homie's dying over hundreds and fifties. I sit back, sip yak, and analyze the situation. And a person alive today knowing the monster we're facing.
To Chicago now, where police are using amateur video of a 16-year-old boy's fatal beating to try and search for suspects in the case. Some people blame gang violence for the brawl that killed Darian Albert. Right now, four people are being questioned in the case.
I don't understand how 16, 17-year-old kids, how you could just stand over someone's body and just constantly beat them and stomp them to death.
We are at war. Many young black men today seem lost, apathetic and disconnected from their past, and definitely uncertain about their futures. For many others, with determination in their eyes, their cries of need have fallen upon deaf ears. For years, the societal ills of high unemployment, plaguing educational disparities, and the systematic breakdown of the black family have resulted in the state of crisis we now find ourselves and our communities in. As we journey through the past, present, and the hope of the future, we hear from a community of word warriors who express their triumphs and challenges through the power of the word. Embrace their perspective on the state of black men in America, the cause and effect of our current condition, how to heal and break this cyclical epidemic of self-destruction.
When we are born black and alive, looking like a long-dead great-grandfather, right then, an invisible stopwatch starts. Milliseconds count as hours when your black boy life is only a coda in the paragraph. And it takes 10,000 of your muscled bodies to stand for Africa in a film, but only one of you dead to stand for America.
Trayvon Martin. Michael Brown. Eric Garner. Tamir Rice. The list is too long. Mothers trying to be strong, crying out, "This can't be." A black man is killed in the United States every 28 hours at the hands of the police or some wannabe cop vigilante. The black male homicide rate is 7 times that of their white male counterparts. One too many broken hearts. One in 3 black males will go to prison in their lifetime, a system that's set up for them to fail with no lifeline. 70% of all men in prison are black or Hispanic. Yes, you should panic. These numbers are on the rise. The United States incarcerates a higher percentage of black men than South Africa did at the height of apartheid. You have the potential to be great. But with numbers like this painting your fate, I understand why you feel like your life don't matter.
When I heard about what happened to Trayvon Martin, it didn't really affect me too much because, like I said, in my life, I didn't hear this shit every day, all day. So to an extent, I am desensitized from it. I'm not surprised by it. I feel like when people do the little, I want to wear a hoodie and post it on Facebook and I am Trayvon Martin, that really don't mean nothing to me because at the end of the day, I'm ready to blow shit up.
The next day, you know what I'm saying, people putting their pictures all on Facebook. But you know what I'm saying, what does it mean? You just hopped on the bandwagon. You weren't thinking about that. You know what I'm saying? Like, come on now, this happens every single day and you finally gonna say something about it because it's getting national publicity? Like, come on now.
As a young person, I think this is like the most extreme case of stereotyping somebody's wardrobe.
But I am urging the parents of black and Latino youngsters particularly to not let their children go out wearing hoodies. I think the hoodie is as much responsible for Trayvon Martin's death as George Zimmerman was. Every time you see someone sticking up a 7-Eleven, the kid's wearing a hoodie. Every time you see a mugging on a surveillance camera or they get the old lady in the alcove, it's a kid wearing a hoodie. You have to recognize that this whole stylizing yourself as a gangster, you're going to be a gangster wannabe. Well, people are going to perceive you as a menace.
I know when I was growing up, my dad was always telling me, don't wear this, don't get earrings, all this other stuff. And I've been put over many a times just for my clothing and just for being black.
You know, I gotta look at the whole picture, you know what I mean? Like, because this is why God wouldn't even thought that Trayvon Martin was a suspect if we didn't portray that type of image in the first place. You know what I mean? We go around doing all types of dirt, you know what I mean? And this type of attire, and this is what we accept. You know what I mean? This is cool. Like, they put us on the news, and we get excited about this type of stuff. Like, you know what I'm saying? I'm gonna go and get this thing. I'm gonna go and get these Chucks, these Dickies. Little kids that don't even bang. This is a cool attire to them, when they might not even know nothing about that lifestyle that goes with wearing Dickies and Chucks and the whole, you know what I mean, fit.
It's like them activists that come hop on a hot issue real quick and say hoorah, hoorah, but the next day they go back to their fat mansion, drive off in their Benz. They could tell me 10 more black kids got killed today. I'm not gonna feel nothing about it because I expect this shit to happen.
Violent weekend in Chicago has left 11 people dead and 60 wounded in shootings across the city. Chicago Police Superintendent Gary McCarthy is addressing the issue as well has recently seized firearms at this hour.
Nonetheless, as you indicated, Corey, there was a count of casualties that could have been from Afghanistan or Iraq, but it was here in Chicago, a place some have dubbed Chirac. The most interesting aspect of this, as we have seen so many times, there were literally a small handful of shootings on the north side, four on the north side, and police say in Englewood alone, one neighborhood on the south side, there were three times as many.
These streets are so deadly. You know, we have a son, our youngest son was shot in the head.
It was a carjacking.
Shot through the car and hit him in the head, and it went under his skin all the way around until it landed just above his eye, sticking out.
One of the guys who was in school with him actually became a doctor. The night that he got shot and all this stuff was going on, he said, "Miss B, I'm gonna become a doctor." I mean, it inspired him because he wanted to help him. If I was only a doctor, if I could only do something. And he actually really did.
When I was doing the research for my play Emergency, I came across a story about an African village, a West African village. And when someone committed a crime in this village, stealing, lying, harming their neighbor in some way, the village would gather around that person and remind them of the good deeds that they've done in the past. And that is something that I believe needs to happen, particularly with our Black boys, reminding them of the truth of who they are, gathering around them and holding up a mirror to the power of who they are. But I also think it's something that needs to happen in the African American community and our nation as a whole.
Ain't no sunshine when he's gone, and he's gone all the time. Mm-hmm. It was the color of his skin that scared them. It wasn't his height. It was the color of his skin that scared them. It wasn't his weight. It was the color of his skin that scared them. It wasn't the wallet. It was the color of his skin that scared them. The wallet was never a gun. It was the color of his skin that scared them. He looked like somebody capitalism taught them to kill. Somebody oppressed. Somebody they could exploit. Somebody from Africa, an immigrant. Somebody whose ancestors were slaves. Like 3/5 of a person. Like somebody it would take 41 bullets to kill. He looked suspicious, like something inhuman, something it would take 41 bullets to kill. He looked like somebody capitalism taught them to kill. It wasn't the wallet. It was the color of his skin that determined his life and death. Four racist police killed one Amadou Diallo 19 times. Those cowards should be in jail, serving 19 plus 41 life sentences in consecutive order. It wasn't the color of his skin.
As a boy, I shared a game with my father. We played it every morning till I was 3. He would knock on my door and I'd pretend to be asleep till he got right next to the bed. Then I would get up and jump into his arms. "Good morning, Papa." And my papa, he would tell me that he loved me. We shared a game, knock, knock. To that day when the knock never came, and my mama takes me on a ride past cornfields on this never-ending highway to reach a place of high, rusty gates. A confused little boy entered the building carried in my mama's arms. Knock, knock. Reach a room of windows and brown faces. Behind one of the windows sits my father. I jump out of my mama's arms and run joyously towards my papa's, only to be confronted by this window. I knock, knock, trying to break through the glass, trying to get to my father. I knock, knock as my mama pulls me away before my papa even says a word. and for years, he has never said a word. And so years later, I write these words for the little boy in me who still awakes his papa's knock. Papa, come home, because I miss you. Miss you waking me up in the mornings and telling me you love me. Papa, come home, says things I don't know, and I thought maybe you could teach me how to shave, how to dribble a ball, how to talk to a lady, how to walk like a man. Papa, come home, because I decided a while back I want to be just like you, but I'm forgetting who you are. And years later, a little boy cries, and so I write these words, and I try to heal, and I try to father myself, and I dream up a father who says the words my father did not. Dear son, I'm sorry I never came home. For every lesson I failed to teach, hear these words. Shave in one direction with strong, deliberate strokes to avoid irritation. Dribble the page with the brilliance of your ballpoint pen. Walk like a child of God and your goddess will come to you. No longer will I beat at a knock on your doors. You must learn to knock for yourself. Knock, knock down doors of racism and poverty that I could not. Knock, knock on doors of opportunity for the lost brilliance of the black men who crowd these cells. Knock, knock with diligence for the sake of your children. Knock, knock for me. For as long as you are free, these prison gates cannot contain my spirit. The best of me still lives in you. Knock, knock with the knowledge that you are my son, but you are not my choices. Yes, we are our father's sons and daughters, but we are not their choices. For despite their absences, we are still here, still alive, still breathing with the power to change this world. One little boy and girl at a time. Knock, knock. Who's there? We are.
My childhood was really influenced by the models of my father and my brother. My father was my principal caregiver the first 3 years of my life, but he was also a heroin addict and heroin dealer. And when I was three, he was arrested. And he spent most of my life in and out of prison. My older brother became addicted to crack cocaine, and he also has dealt with incarceration. So much of who I thought I could be in my formative years was influenced by who my father and brother were, their battles with addiction and incarceration. And it was in a journey to actually discover my love of words through a mentor named Mavis Jackson when I was in third grade, who helped me write my first speeches after playing a videotape of Dr. King's I Have a Dream speech that opened my eyes to a different possibility of who I could be as a black man and how I could use words not only to shift my reality but to inspire other people.
Those times when my dad wasn't there, like after he would beat me, I would write. After something just harsh, some situation I was going through, I would write. And as I got older, that was the only thing that stayed with me. You know, and I just, that became my outlet. And it actually did transform me because it made me more sympathetic towards other people. Because after I would reread my stuff, and then I go talk to somebody, I'd be like, damn, you're going through the same shit that I just wrote about.
Though my father did not live in the house, he was very present in my life. So I think on one level, there's a certain generation of young men that we, you know, need to, you know, address the issue of if you've got kids, and even if you and the mother do not get along, your responsibility is still to that child. And not living in the house does not mean you, you know, don't have to be or cannot be in the kid's life. So I think that's one issue.
Well, not having my father in the household, it was pretty hard. I mean, because I would see my mom struggling a lot raising two kids, and it kind of seemed impossible, but somehow she made it work. And the only thing that really, well, as growing up, I was wondering, where was my dad? How come my dad's not in my life? And why this had to happen to me? But just growing up, I see in a society that majority of black kids, they grow up without a father.
If my natural father was to walk in this place right now, I wouldn't know he was my natural father. I've never seen him. So I realized that this whole concept of it takes a village to raise a child, that's a very realistic thing for black folks. I mean, you know, we get the wisdom and the lessons from wherever we can get them from. And it could be from somebody that's not even a relative. But I had a aunt that was better than most mothers, and I had an uncle that was better than most fathers, so I was blessed.
And I think you have to explain to some of the young brothers that there is a balancing out. Okay, your dad is in jail, but your granddaddy comes down here even to pick you up because he don't want you getting in no trouble.
Tonight, the uncle of a slain teenager defends what he calls an act of love. The Tarrytown teen made internet headlines after he was seen being disciplined by his uncle for claiming to be a gangster just last week. The young man was shot to death outside of his home. WDSU reporter Sydney Chewin spoke to the teen's family.
I regret maybe not being a part of his life a little bit more after the video.
I'm hurt. I'm not angry, but I'm hurt. I'm hurt. My boy was my world.
So it's important for uncles, grandfathers, and women need to be thinking about what boyfriend they're gonna have when they got children. And is that boyfriend gonna have a job? Is he gonna be coming around to visit? Or is he coming around to spend the night? Is he coming around to spend some time with you and your children? Will he be able to talk some sense into your kid before he gets senseless?
Male role models. They were a big substitute for me. They were always involved in my life. They introduced me to athletics and sports, gave me many opportunities. I never forget my sixth grade teacher, Mr. Thornton. He always said, if you're gonna be the best at everything that you can be. You wanna be a fireman, be the best. You wanna be the garbage man, be the best garbage man in the whole wide world. So they were always positive, always striving for us young men to be the best, knowing that we don't have biological father in our lives, but them taking the place and making sure they give us positive motivation at all times. I was really, really appreciative of that.
So to that young black man who has the fire in him already, seek knowledge. Grab hold of anyone, even if you don't have anybody in your household, an educator, a teacher. They were definitely, I would say, role models in my life, a teacher. And if you go and express to almost any teacher that you want to be better, that you want to grow, that you want to achieve, they're going to take some time out and share some knowledge with you.
I do have a mentor, you know, per se. That's the word we're gonna use, but I just look at him like a big brother, you know.
Brother to brother, father to son, mentor to mentee. It's gotten chesty sometimes the way men do, like, oh, come on, man, you tripping.
You know, he just planted seeds in my brain and like really be a man, like always has a business about yourself. Like, you know, he gave me a place to stay when my people put me out. Always had my back, always willing to like challenge my thought process. If I'm talking about some nonsense, he'll be like, look, man, that's some bullshit, look, and give me the right answers. Some stuff I wouldn't agree with, but later on in life, I would like recognize.
If I could look in my daughter's eyes, I would tell them to be with a man like me at the end of the day, really. To be with a man that is willing to fight and not accept anything. Be with a man that's willing to die for what he believes in and is willing to do whatever he has to do to, you know, make a difference.
What a beautiful scenery we failed to see. Damaged our shield, now it's heating the sea. Bloodshed every day, and we wonder why it's days like this. Now, if you were a dad, wouldn't you be pissed? It seems we've totally lost our way. I'm not perfect, but I know I love the day. I smile and say hi sincerely to those that walk my way, not understanding unnecessary hate. Some say it's a necessary evil. Is it really? I thought we were created equal. What happened to love? What happened to peace? Why everybody wanna be a thug? And why is it cool to slang drugs and gloated upon when you killed him with your gun? Are we that blinded, accepting the fact we're running around like tyrants? You love violence? You know we were meant to be timeless. So as I pray, because I know they won't like what I say, lead them, Lord, because I guess they don't know. We'll be back one day.
The world is so lovely. The world is so ugly. The world is so confused. Fuck the world. The world can't judge me. I am the last outlaw, rebel without a cause. Never been on World Star. Why? Because I'm too fucking raw. The whole world watched the World Trade Center fall. Now it's a world war going on. The world is lost. Said all I got in this world is my word and my boss. If the world don't pay attention, then the world gonna pay the cost. The street life is the only life that I know. Keep my ear to the streets. I am the heart and the soul. Word on the streets is my heart turned cold. Seen the streets break niggas. Man, the streets ain't no joke. Seen the streets erase niggas. Man, the streets ain't got no hope. People sleeping on the streets because they got no place to go. The streets is a motherfucker. The streets is crazy. But I never turn my back on the streets because the streets made me.
While violence in our communities are at an all-time high, more funding for after-school programs are being cut. Youth are feeling displaced, feeling unsettled and unsafe, with nowhere to turn but to the beat of the streets. How many more community centers will become obsolete? I need my village to raise me, so that the rhythm of my feet can lead me to a prosperous and fulfilling destiny. It takes a village.
The year that I started the center was 1990. And funding was hard to come by. I had to give up my paycheck and give up my house to keep it going.
This center is in the middle of South Central Los Angeles, in the middle of a very violent gang area.
At the time, I think it was like 92, 93, and it was hectic out here in LA, real hectic. You know, we had the riots, you had the Bloods and the Crips at an all-time high, drugs and everything was going on.
What they did for me was show me something different. They used to take us on these trips, take us, you know, we had all these different people just coming through speaking to us, you know, so it just put me in a really, really good position to expand my mind as a little kid. So all I saw wouldn't just be this prostitute or this gang member or, you know, just all the stuff that just comes with being in South Central Los Angeles. It gave me an opportunity to see that this is a big, big world that we're living in.
Over the years, I've seen kids grow, come here and couldn't read, and some of them couldn't write, and some of them was even homeless. And I've seen all of that change. Getting the kids off the street was the answer. And getting the right staff, got a really good staff to work with the kids.
It's so big. It's so much bigger than just a building off of Western. This is a place where a little kid can come and just find out that they can live, man.
And I think we get to a point where, you know, young people are just, you know, bombarded with so much negativity and so many, you know, misfortunes in life that at an early age, you know, they forget to dream.
I remember Bev Smith when she had a show on BET. We were on there and I talked about what I do at the open house and how it came out of the fact that I played basketball with a lot of guys at my son's age. And then bring them over to the house and we share poetry and we eat and stuff like this. So this guy from Milwaukee called and says, "Well, brother, I'm kind of overweight and I don't play basketball, man, but I would like to do what you're doing." I said, "Well, it must be some game you play." He said, "I play chess." I said, "Well, hook up a chess thing." Do you know this guy did that in about 5 years later? He called me and told me they came in second in the championship chess tournament in the country.
You allow people to make mistakes, especially kids. And if they make a mistake, you know, help them learn from it. And if they make it again, try to help them learn from it again. That's what and if they make it, you know, keep helping them until they get over it. People, you know, they just, you know, people like give up on people if they don't do what you want them to do.
You know what I mean? See, people say, "Well, I don't want to do that, or I just want to go do what I want to do." But that's not responsible. See, it's not responsible because you are part of this community. And whether you do something or don't do something, it affects it.
This obsession with just getting by or taking care of one's personal needs for those who in one's immediate circle has consequences that we may not see in the immediate but have long-term consequences. We are designed to be responsible for one another.
And there's a lot of brilliant people walking around who say, "I don't even bother with that," you know, and that's unfortunate. A lot because they've been mistreated trained, they've been propagandized, you know, and they think the best thing to do is get out of here, the first thing smoking.
You know, we don't have those mentors next to us that's the doctor, the lawyer, or the dentist. We got the dope dealer, the hooker, you know what I mean? Yeah. You know, or the crackhead on the street, and more or less in our neighborhoods. If we're fortunate enough not to live in those neighborhoods, we might have somebody to mentor us, but they ain't got time for it.
I think it's just a lack of guidance. I think it's because what seems to be normal, you know, just growing up in a community where that's running rampant, it seems like the thing to do. You know what I mean? I can't get a job, or I don't want a job. This guy over here already has a Bentley at 20, so I'm gonna do what he did. I'm gonna follow him.
We live in a very self-important age where everybody's so busy taking pictures of themselves and posting them on the internet, and taking pictures of the food that they're eating. We're not, our lens isn't pointed back out in the world, at the world, you know? It's, and when it's pointed at us, it's pointed at our aesthetic. It's not pointed at what's going on with us internally.
Because we get caught up in what we gonna be as opposed to who we wanna be. And I think it should be explained to them early enough the difference in who and what. They are not objects. They're not things. They're people that have the potential of bringing more life force. And it's the people's responsibility that's here first to be responsible for the next generation coming up. I don't care what new philosophies out there. Positive human development always works the same way.
More sweat pours down my face as I continue to run at a pace that's got my heart pumping and veins popping. Damn near ready to drop this struggle to stay in the game, only stopping to catch my breath for a sec. Oh, it's insane the way I train, bench pressing hypotheses and philosophies on how to play out this game called life. You know, I squat and do lunges with pressures that weigh a ton on my shoulders, and the older I get, the bolder are my fantasies of how I can win at this. Sometimes I watch my self-esteem slowly steam out past my lips upon exhalation. And since I have yet to be drafted by any of these top religious teams, I replenish my own soul with meditations of honor and praise for the Most High and plenty of thanks for the blessings bestowed. I try hard to abstain and refrain from this feeling of being owed some type of explanation. Damn it, God! Why give me a mind to choose only to have me compete in this game called life when it's clearly designed for me to lose?
Young men and at-risk youth in our inner city sometimes feel hopeless, stuck, and develop the attitude of, I don't give a fuck. From the pressure of living in poverty, surviving, trying to stay alive, to having a stigma placed on them because they did some time. As a result, businesses shy away from them when it comes to work for hire. A brother feels like he ain't got no choice but to turn to gangs, robbing and selling drugs. It's the same story, different day. But all is not lost despite federal budget cuts. Dear Congress, remember you work for the people, not the other way around. Get it right. We need more businesses and training programs to give our boys hope and an opportunity to do it right. Holla back if you hear us.
You gotta realize we ain't got no jobs around here or nothing, you know? So every time we try to make a little something to get on our feet, to try to help our feed our family, they come kicking the doors in.
Because you bring them down to this type of level where they feel like I don't got nothing to live for anyway. They're gonna try to take me out anyway.
The way the world is set up, in my opinion, is for people like myself to fail. So I have to constantly be on my toes and watch the choices I make, because the consequence might not fit that choice. It might just totally just, you know, be crazy. It might be the end of my life.
Why is it that one standard is in one community and another standard is in another? Well, it has to do with race and it has to do with money.
But they don't know it's capitalism. They think it's that they're not successful. It's not your, they won't let you be successful.
That kind of goes back to the question, like, are we set up? In instance, we are, but we don't have to accept it, though. I mean, I don't have to pick up an AK, you know what I'm saying? I can go ahead and handle my dispute a different way.
So along with teaching personal responsibility, we also need to talk about how American culture gathers itself around keeping certain people in a servant class and keeping a significant amount of the population locked in cages.
If one in three black boys, one in two in urban centers are spending time in prison, that is a large segment of our population that is not being fathers. That is a large segment of our population that is not contributing to society in a healthy way.
There's this thing going on in California where they were kicking so many black boys out of school. I'm talking about they're suspending fourth grade boys that the districts were realizing we're losing money. Because when we're kicking the boys out of class, when we're suspending them, they're not in school. The state pays us to educate the kid. So what they come up with brilliantly and devilishly is in-school suspension, where now they suspend the boy out of class, but put him in this baby penitentiary, so he's still on campus, so technically the boy is getting an education because he's in school, but he's not getting an education. He's being marginalized in from the school culture, and then those statistics are used to validate putting police on the campus.
There was a time when we were handed a baton from our elders. That baton was filled with wisdom. It was our African tradition to help guide us, give us strength, and make sound decisions. Their stories never grew old, but today, those stories have grown silent and have stopped being told because these kids think Lil Wayne is a hero, while the legacies of King, Farmer, Cleaver, and McLeod grow cold. Now look where we are as a whole, clueless, with no direction of who we are and which way to go. Our ancestors have not stopped speaking. We have just stopped listening. Listen up. You might just learn who you really are.
I was supposed to follow the path of my father, my grandfather, and go into the fields and, you know, be a sharecropper and all of that. And as far as the South, the Southern culture was concerned, that was all I was supposed to do. But something happened to interrupt that process. And what happened was my grandparents, although they were not educated people, they did have a very distinct sense of history. They knew what had gone before and what they had had to go through, and they were determined that there would be a different future for those coming along behind. So they determined that no matter what the obstacles were, we're going to get the best education available.
I came humming, rich in mahogany, like the healing sap of the eucalyptus in my grandma's hand. I came to make you joy with the innocence of my childhood, to let you taste the proud of my youth, and let you catch a glimpse of my manhood, giving you pearls of memories to grow into the wise of your aging. Now I have passed over. Now I am rising, stripped of time and space, passing into the twilight, the early of my twilight, to wake into another sphere, to sing above your head like the music of the wind, to dance on untrodden fields. I am rising, circling the seasons, unbroken. I am rising, my love wrapped around you. No hand can erase. I am rising, the sun song, the spirit song, God's seed. A love supreme to be ever more near to thee.
So I was one of two children that was born here. My mother's family is from Alabama. My father's family is from South Carolina. The Alabama people, my mother and them, they burned my grandfather's store down a couple of times. This town was, like I say, integrated. They had some race riots, 1948. About the time I graduated from elementary school, they had a race riot here between the Italians and the blacks. And a guy in my class was killed in that. You know, that was a kind of early recognition. He was killed. He was killed because he won the track meet. Ain't it too bad, y'all said? Ain't it too bad, such a nice boy? Always kind to his mother. Always say good morning to everybody on his way to work. But the last time before he got locked up and hurt real bad, I seen him walking toward his house and he wasn't smiling and he didn't even say hello. But I knew he'd seen something, something in the way of things. And it worked on him like it do and will. And he kept marching faster and faster away from us and never even muttered a word. Then the next day, he was gone. Da 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 da.
You know, for centuries, black men, when they saw each other, because I've read about it and experienced it, when black men saw each other, they did like that. Or if you do that now, they just have, the black youngsters have this vague look. I've never seen it before all of my life since I was a kid. My father doing it, my big brothers, my uncle, we'd be traveling. And as soon as they saw another black man or a black family or a black person, you know, there was this. And you do that and they look at you like, they're thinking like, what is he, a faggot? You know, you're coming on to them. And so I contributed something called Boys in Search of Their Solar System. Solar System, S-O-U-L-A-R. Our boys are short-fused in their short-changed hood. Yo, gangbangs reign where playgrounds grandly stood. Shooters drive by. Teen dreams dive for covers. Nightmares stroke them like they were old lovers. L.A., Haiti, Kemet, Kingston, blues grooves, hip hop, gangbang, talk slop, school thing, cool move. A swarm of conflict plagues their short-fused hood, where walking death is forced to knock on wood. But boys must bond with brothers black, unbind their minds too roughly wrapped in wondrous noise. Though black and short-fused in the fatal line, their solar system give them ancient poise.
I really began to emerge into my poetic prominence as far as I was concerned when I wrote a piece called My People, which was getting away from the nigger poetry, because in the last poets we were trying to eradicate niggers and we niggerfied everybody. I mean, we said run nigger, die nigger, wake up niggers. We talked about niggers, niggers on dick other people, niggers scared of revolution, nigger, nigger, nigger. We had more nigger poems than you could shake a stick at. Then I decided that I was gonna write a non-nigger poem, and I entitled it My People. And so my people are black, beige, yellow, brown, and beautiful. A garden of life where the love is sweet as scooping all wine.
Growing in muddy waters, making brown babies with pink feet and quick minds. My people warm, sometimes hot, always cool, always together, together in church and school and jail and the service, in the streets of the ghettos throughout this forsaken land. My people, let's be together. Understand that we've lived together, understand that we've died together. Understand, my brother, I've smelled your piss in my hallway and it smells just like mine. Understand that I love your woman, my sister, and her rare beauty is reason enough for a revolution. Yes, sister, my honest sister, I've had ugly moments with you, but you're the only beauty I've ever known.
We have become a culture who has lost a sense of our past. Did you know that the Voting Rights Act for Blacks, signed into law August 6, 1965, is now in jeopardy of being non-existent? Pure facts. So, has the sacrifice of lives, blood, sweat, tears, and pain that our people went through to gain freedom just gone down the drain? We can't let this take place. Or we may as well go back to the days of slavery and let the KKK taunt us in blackface. It's about knowing our history and what's at stake. Education is key so that we can know where to go from here as a human race.
The Supreme Court has just issued a ruling in a case challenging part of a historic voting rights law.
The lawsuit focuses on the federal government's power to review any change in voting procedures. It applies to 16 states where there's a history of discrimination against minority voters.
Longtime civil rights activists feel like the strides made over the last many decades have been lost.
It's very painful for me. I have friends who are in the graveyard for the right to vote.
School was very important. Teachers were respected then because that's what you were told to do. And there was a lot more autonomy that school officials had.
We've come to a pretty dangerous time. There's a collapse of virtually every system that should and traditionally has supported young people.
Whenever we talk about tragic parts of Black folks' history, we talk about slavery, we talk about lynching, we talk about Jim Crow, we talk about the Civil Rights Movement, and now we talk about how we're failing in education.
I think that we've got to get deeply involved in our concept of education, not just in terms of reading, writing, and arithmetic, but in terms of how education is going to serve us.
The education system is failing our children. It's not our system.
These schools are not teaching you what you should know. They're not teaching you about the history of this country. They're not teaching you anything that will help your consciousness.
Other people celebrate their culture and it's just culture. We celebrate it and it becomes Black militancy. And Black folks are very afraid of white people being afraid of us.
When I started school and knew how to read, my father was giving me poetry books. He was giving me books on Langston Hughes, on Richard Wright, on Malcolm X, on Marian Anderson, Mary McLeod Bethune. So he was, at such a young age, he was instilling, you know, so much, you know, of the culture in me.
You never hear somebody, a Korean person, going to a Korean parade or eating at a Korean restaurant, somebody telling a Korean, oh, there you go on that Korean stuff, you know? But Black folks go to, you know, I'm going over to the park today. They're having a Black culture thing in the park today. Shh, here you go with that Black power. So, you know, it's a weird kind of derogatory thing that's placed on us.
Let's take young Malcolm X, pimp, hustler, no possibilities of going anywhere in life, being able to navigate that life that he grew up in, you know, in the streets, and yet using the most difficult set of circumstances, being on lockdown in prison, that 7 years became a university for him.
See yourself at war to battle ignorance, battle illiteracy, battle sexism.
Not the victim, you know, but to be, you know, the one, the transformer, the one who uses difficult circumstances the creative mind, the mentality connected with knowledge to flip that script and become the Superman that Malcolm became.
I never experienced getting a diploma at all. At all. Like, my last diploma I got was kindergarten.
I met a woman named Shirley Jaffe while I was at the center. I think I was around 7 years old. And, you know, basically, see, they saw me as a youngster that they could really, like, take to the next level in life, like on some, you know, trading places type stuff. Like, they took me out the hood and straight to Bel Air and Beverly Hills.
When I got my GED, I was like, I can go inside of a job now and put it on my application and all of that. You know what I'm saying? It was a real good moment for me because I had never really accomplished anything.
I was going to the best school probably any little kid could go to in his fourth grade, called John Thomas Dye, where the tuition is about $2,000 a semester.
Yeah, I mean, I really focused. I mean, I had to be in jail to do it, but I really, I mean, I sat down and put the time in. You know, I mean, I studied and all of that. I had to relearn math and everything. Like, so it was really a big thing for me because, you know, I showed myself that I could.
I blew that opportunity because I had my behavior issues and I went to that school being the same Greg Bell, you know, smart but bad.
I just remember being in there and just hearing people just yelling, "Schoolboy, oh, you a bitch. Oh, you ain't really with the business, nigga, you's a bitch." Just, these are the people that I looked up to. Like, y'all really want me here with y'all? Like, you supposed to be like, "Hey, man, go get your shit, man, go get it, don't never come back here." I didn't hear none of that, though.
I'm grateful it kind of worked out the way it did because I know I would have became detached from what's really going on in the world because at 7 years old, no matter, you know, I was going through so much and I saw a lot of stuff, I know I probably would have been a little asshole, rich kid, you know, like, "Oh, I got out the hood. Why you can't get out the hood?"
I could have turned around and be like, "Y'all go ahead, get your GED. I'ma stay back here with these niggas and I'ma program, when it crack off, I'ma be here with them." I could have did that, but I didn't.
We see whether these young men are going to schools that are private schools or if they're going to low-funded, underfunded public schools, they're having some of the same issues. And the reason is that our children are socially handicapped.
All of those support systems that should develop and nurture young people are failing and have failed. Families are broken. Fathers and mothers have been divided and away so long that it's difficult to find their way back. When they do get back, if they do get back, there's a challenge on how do we relate to one another.
I think if the parents would really step up, you know, and do what they did when we were kids, you know, you got these spankings from the neighbor. They brought you down the street and you were crying and your mother was asked what happened and the neighbor would tell you and then your mama would take over. You got another spanking. And if pops was there, you got another spanking. You know, maybe brother might even get on. But by the time you got finished with those whippings, it might have been child abuse or whatever you want to call it, but you weren't doing it no more.
There was a stronger sense of responsibility and connection between collectivism and individualism, I think. There was more collectivism being taught. We talk about families that come here, immigrants here, where there's several family members living in one household. But that used to be Black America.
My Black grandma kicked my Black ass out the house. That's when I really found out what being Black's about. Ready to black out, all I seen was black clouds and black in mouths, just black scream and black shout. Mass amounts of black bodies drop like rain. I go to a black church where the black preacher ain't stopping my pain. He never talk about a black Jesus or a black God. When I do, to tell the truth, even blacks look at me strange. But what if God was one of us? It's another black boy in the back seat of a black and white being read his rights while handcuffed. Would he stand up or be ashamed? Well, I ain't. I'm black and proud like James Brown minus the cocaine. They say blacks won't vote so our conditions stay the same. But even if the president is black, he gotta live in a white house. So what would blacks really gain? No time for silly games. I got the answer. Get a strap and be prepared to attack like the Black Panther. Nigga, we gotta fight or die. Like the blacks in Somalia who shot a black hawk out the sky. Black thoughts proud my mind. But that don't mean I'm thinking negative. That what they got y'all thinking black represents. It's bad luck if you see a black cat wear black clothes at a funeral because you sad. does mean love to see a black bro and death is coming fast. Black magic, oh no, I don't fuck with that. And everybody heard the saying, once you go black, what?
You never go back.
I ain't against you, I'm just pro black. Cause your judicial system ain't cutting poor blacks no slack. I hear my peers, but I listen to the old blacks that could go back to the 60s, where blacks wasn't worried about making millions, cause we was making history. Black history, every single day, every single night, every single second of your motherfucking life.
It was 1973, the year poetry married hip-hop. It don't stop. DJ Kool Herc rocked the spot, laying the first block of the foundation in the South Bronx. The time had come for melodic words that rhyme to join forces with break beats. Let the poet speak. The cipher, full of poets and drums, was maturing and giving birth to rhyme and song. Many said that this movement wouldn't last long, but today, hip-hop still stands strong and is the most influential form of music on the planet. See, hip-hop and poetry are not just words. They are our culture, our lifestyle, a culture we created from the suffering of our African ancestors that brought our souls back to life. Hip-hop is our power. And through it, we must pay homage to those who first broke poetic barriers and found this new sound. From Grandmaster Flash, Afrika Bambaataa, and Curtis Blow, to Public Enemy, Poor Righteous Teachers, Tupac, and The Wu, you know. She should be respected, loved, and used to build us up. Let that sink in for a minute.
My views about hip-hop culture, you know, it's mixed emotions, you know. I love parts of it, I don't like parts of it.
The average little brother walking around America is learning manhood from television and the radio.
Buns and Weed, a Memphis Boys provocative Instagram page, which includes pictures and video of himself smoking marijuana and posing with guns, is sparking outrage. And tonight, that boy talks via Twitter, only to Fox 13's Sarah Blue. She joins us now live. So, Sarah, he really doesn't seem to have a care in the world about the image that he's putting out there.
After posting this story to my social media, Jonathan starts tweeting me. He wouldn't call to talk, but tweeted directly to me, quote, "People going to hate. Regardless, I'm good." I asked why he posted these pictures. He replied, "Chief Keef, a Chicago rapper, got famous from that, right?"
I heard songs as a kid, and it really made me want to be a killer. I heard songs as a kid that made me want to help people, you know, but without a strong parent around, hip-hop will raise your child.
There is a lot of superficiality being celebrated, and I think that we have to be careful to remember that words have creative power.
Then the kids buy it, and that's why you see a lot of people emulate these rappers, either for the good or the bad. You know, from I'ma sell drugs just cause he said that's what it is. But this dude that's saying he sell drugs probably ain't never sold no drugs in his life. And guess what? After he finished rocking the mic, he go back to his mansion with his bodyguards, and your black ass is right there in the ghetto with no protection.
That mass media doesn't have an interest in his development. That mass media has an interest in selling him a CD. You know, imagine the person, if the source that's supposed to give you guidance in life only cares about you buying a CD or a car or a pair of shoes.
It is this system, it is the system of capitalism who exploits, and now what they're doing is exploiting our children's consciousness. They're making them believe that once they're on television and once they get this, they're going to be rewarded. Yes, they're going to be rewarded with death.
Rap lyrics cracked a cold case.
Tonight, a Newport newsman is charged in two murders. Detectives say the suspect's own song lyrics led them right to him.
Listen, walk to your boy and I close them. 12 midnight on this trap house butcher. Everybody saw when I'm choked them, but nobody saw when I'm smoked them.
The music you listen to does have an effect on how you see yourself and how you see life.
And so this war of words that we see in hip-hop, even that we see in reality TV and some of the appalling images that are put forth in these conversations and these arguments, we have to realize that they have creative power. They are not only creating reality for the people who hear them in this country, but they're traveling all over the world.
Young people now who grow up in hip hop, all they know is gangster rap and post gangster rap hip hop.
We go to now and it's like, you know, fuck a bitch. You know, I got big K's. You talking about killing.
So there won't be a song called White Girl Bend Over Touch Your Toes. Cause we ain't really comfortable with that, you know. But you know, black bitch turn around. And they only say black bitch, but you know when you're hearing about the bitches and the hoes, that's a black woman. When you hear about the cat getting shot, that's a brother, you know that.
You have this happen where kids can't get whoopings no more, then all of a sudden you have weapons come in, and then you have songs talking about using the weapons. You know what I'm saying? So it's actions speak louder than words, man. It's something seriously against us, especially in this community.
I think it go back to not having a father in the home, and a lot of these youngsters is weak and scared to fight. So instead of taking a ass whooping like a man, or learning how to defend yourself in the proper way, they run and get a gun. And we all know that's a sucker move, you know? And generation after generation has been desensitized. We don't have no understanding of who we are as a people. And we don't have no love for ourselves. That's why it's so easy for us to destroy ourselves.
I think we've gotten to a point now where, you know, 20, 25 years later, we're actually looking at the effect of hip hop on our young people, on the lifestyle, on the psyche.
What do you think needs to be changed in the way black men are policed in America?
Leave that up with the critics and the laws and all that old shit. We having fun, we iced out, we having money. Leave that up with the critics and the laws and all that old shit. We having fun, we iced out, we having money. That's how we doing it.
So you feel like it's not the artist's place to speak on social issues?
No.
I think it's important for poets to take some responsibility for the conditions in which we live. And I think it's our responsibility to teach. We're like teachers. And if we can put it in a poem, they might listen, or a song for that matter. You know, many people were influenced by Public Enemy, you know, back in the day. That's when rap was good, so to speak. It wasn't about bling bling and all of that.
Hip hop has a lot of influence on the world, and hip hop has a lot of power. So my approach to hip hop is to like really influence the world, like with truth.
Where are you running to? Who are you running from? Who do you want to be? Who are you running from? Where are you running to? Where do you want to be? I tread the mic lightly, for no MC. For no MC is worth my sanity. 6-6 licks I spit for the purpose of vanity. Treat whack lyricists like profanity. Swing a track like Jane swings calamity to the clips empty. Tricks pimp me in their minds, but I refuse to bind my soul for a 6-record deal and maybe one hit song. Twice screams to get your nice dreams like Chong or Cheech, but I beseech you to teach a few lessons with your blessings. Clock your actions, watch your verbal transactions, and stop acting like you don't know the shorties are listening while the whole world is listening to your bling. Singing sad songs, the white man's done you wrong, is a thing of the past. So I'm just trying to flash through, cause crying's only gonna last you but for so long. And I need the Most High to help me hold on for when I can't go on. Where are you running from? Who are you running to? Who do you wanna be? Who are you running from? Where are you running to? Where do you wanna be? You talk, you choke, you burn your throat, because this here is hotness. I got this like game, names fabled like the Loch Ness. Moth through the flame, can't you see my desire when I spit fire to your grill? With the will of Job, I disrobe those who spit more fluff than vampires in the buff. And no, I can't stop until you get enough positivity in your veins, blowing the negative out your mainframe. Could you possibly maintain when true poets change the game, and you can only make a name by bringing substance to the cipher? And a love for life when the system makes you want to give up because it feels like you don't have enough in your cup? Cats get stuck running amok in the fields of false green. I come with a boss team of spirituality, love, and self-esteem. And I'ma keep rolling and flowing until they tell me end of scene. Where are you running from? Who are you running to? Who do you want to be?
It's a takedown, a lyrical shakedown. I'm waiting for MCs to break down the truth of who's responsible for our youth, because we're all proof in the pudding that those who said we couldn't were dead wrong. But come on, now we got dead songs celebrating dead palms of brothers and sisters. I enlist the MCs and the poets of today to write our own book like Psalms come our judgment day. I drop lyrical bombs that cause mayday for the unenlightened and the frightened until they say, I want more. I score in the lead that's made by few when I'm used as a vessel to peek into what you need to hear. I do not fear the devil because his playground can't match the level of my spiritual path. I laugh at these cats who take fame so seriously, and I'm deliriously amused when asked to catch wreck on the microphone check 1, 2, or 3. LA, holla if you feel me.
Right here, right now, the struggle has been real. You see, I speak of the struggle as past tense. Right here, right now, let's be the village that we used to be. Right here, right now, let's take responsibility for us and eliminate the crab in a barrel mentality. If we fed each other, we wouldn't have to rob one another to eat. Right here. Right now, take the vow. Let's get back to the philosophy that there is no I in we.
And I know this sounds kind of corny, but you gotta find a way to care about other people. And you've got to become one and grasp whether, I don't care if they black, Latin, Asian, or white, but in our community, they're mostly black and Latinos. And we've got to learn that we are the same people under the same conditions, and we must unite to fight them back. We can't let this system kill us.
Every hardship that you have gone through, someone has gone through it already. And though you cannot control, other things that may happen to you, you can control how you respond.
Instead of doing things to hurt you and hurting somebody else, go back to your book, write in your book, write them thoughts down. Because one day your stories can help another kid see the light at the end of the tunnel.
Oh, oh, oh. Yeah, yeah. What I've seen was meant for me. My struggle has given me strength. They built me, they teach me how to keep fighting for my dream game. Oh, 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 oh. Now I have peace because I felt me.
I had a talk with Jeffrey Canada and Carol Dune over at the Promise Academy about a couple of years ago. And I was telling them, I said, since you're all doing this new school thing, I said, we want to get our people on point. I said, play some jazz while they're changing classes, while they're sitting on the john, while they're eating lunch. Because that music, it does a whole different thing to your mindset. It make you think. And it makes you think of things that are gonna maybe take you to different places that you haven't thought about before, but it's gonna make you think.
We need a serum, not a literal serum liquid, but some kind of formula or a combination of formulae that would bring everybody into consciousness.
One of the things that really bothers me is that we have the medicine to change the way they think, to quiet some of that rage.
And that's what the think tank I belong to has been working on for almost 50 years, trying to put it together. One of these young boys might have teeth.
because there's a lot of lack of consciousness with these kids. A lot of them are just acting off of energy that's just scattered all over the place. There's no real rhyme or reason half the time.
What's yours? Where are the parts of your guys' future?
Say it one more time.
Where are the parts of your guys' future?
Man, my future looking bright, man, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, all I can say is that I'm gonna try to keep doing the right thing and keep coming back here, you know, to help you with your future, all right?
Our lives matter. There is hope, and there will always be. Poverty and negativity may be a reality, but it's about making up our minds to no longer accept an asinine mind. Just like our thoughts can create a mind of defeat, it is possible to create a world of peace. Let's not limit ourselves to someone else's thoughts of who we be, but dwell in the limitless loving realm of who we were created to be. Our lives matter.
Word warrior to me goes back to my basic introduction to the word. In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God.
And Proverbs also tells us, as a man thinketh, so is he. And we learn in the Bible also that God said, let there be, and there was.
Crucify Jesus Christ, or Marcus Garvey for rice, shot Malcolm X in the chest, gave Nelson Mandela life. Pac died at 25, Biggie died a year younger. All my life been broke. I'm motivated by my hunger.
You could actually be sentenced to 3 years, no parole, and use a poem as evidence that you had started this rebellion.
And I found that, oh, you can do this? I mean, you could move people like this? I said, I think I want to get in that.
See, the mother brothers will make you dance, but justice will make you think. You saving up for a Bentley, I'm saving up for a tank. That's just the mindset of a soldier. Shit is crazy, huh? This is what I see.
They can use those words to hurt or to heal.
Like Martin Luther King is dead, but we're still saying his I Have a Dream speech. And these were his words.
Told my mama bury me with a 357 just in case God tripping, I don't get into heaven. If he send me to hell, then oh well. Because I just did 25 years in the ghetto as a black male. And it can't get much harder than that. Had a lot of pain in my heart. That's why I started to rap.
You can't utter the words without performing the defense and sometimes the offense that's involved in the war.
I definitely will fight with my words before I move with my fists.
The name Pat's Justice is basically comes from my uncle Patrick, who passed away, and I named myself Pat's Justice, meaning I was going to be justice for my uncle because I felt like his life was cut short. The night before his funeral, I sat down at the table and I just looked at the clock. It was like 7 o'clock and I'm sitting at the table and I just start writing. And then the next day I read it at his funeral and it was like making peace with him. Everybody like stood up at a funeral. You know, you get a standing ovation at a funeral. It's like, showed me the power of words and it kind of helped me get through that situation. We are no longer slaves, but we sure ain't free. So until I ain't gotta kill and steal from my own folks, tattooed across my soul are these words I just spoke. So who the fuck y'all gonna call when I break all the laws on behalf of every innocent criminal?
Same crown, same mission, different lifetime.
Royal blood still pumping through my pipeline. More wealth than a $1 billion oil mine. Go deep, take a seat, throne so divine. In the beginning was the word, so I still rhyme. This time I'm spitting fire, that'll cease fire. Put down the guns before the sun, release fire. Open your mind, two fingers more than a peace sign. Walk peace, speak more of a peace mind. You give me head and I'm giving you a peace of mind. Two intellectuals conversing with a peace of mind. Whoever said loving you was a crime, lie. Must have been the same one who let the soul die. Well, I'm here to be the light and bring you back alive. Worst come to worst, don't say I never ever try. Who can I trust if I can't trust you, huh? Everywhere I turn is lies. In these streets feeling stuck with no luck. Give me no choice but to turn up. All the way up, time to wake up. We at war on so many levels, each level represented by a different devil. Armored up Nick Cannon like Incredible. I partake from the tree so edible. Not to be deceived twice, I got a mouthful. Ammunition fully loaded, ready, set, pull. I'm so gangster, so God, so Einstein. Vibrating at the highest of my spirit mind. If you don't get it, it's okay, you ain't there yet. I'm taking off for a flight like a fighter jet. Been here before, label me a war vet. As above, so
thank you for those of you who are with us. Thank you for sharing this space with us as we have a short conversation with the film's director. And then, of course, Jibari Tidmore, who is a leader, community activist leader, and generator in the team, the Inglewood community. Today is February 20th. It is Black Future Month, hashtag Black Future Month, people have been saying apparently on social media. It's also the day before we recognize the assassination of Martin Luther King. So we recognize the loss, but we also celebrate the gift. And I think that we have to celebrate those of us who are with us who are also making contributions to our community. So I would like to note the fact that Ms. Breen also has founded and directs, although it's virtual right now, her own community center, which is the We Reach Media Arts and Tech Center in the heart of Los Angeles. And you may want to speak for a moment about that as well, TIZZI.
Yes, thank you. Oh, sorry. I'm sorry.
Listening.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I recently started my nonprofit. It's been a dream of mine for years. Like the Al Wooten Youth Center in South Central Los Angeles that you saw featured in the film is actually a center where I grew up, and I'm an alumni, and literally landed in there running, like dodging bullets. So it literally saved my life. That was in the early 90s. If it wouldn't have been for the Al Wooten Youth Center, you know, I probably wouldn't be here today. So I just wanted to create a space and opportunity for other at-risk youth in the community to have a place to be able to contribute, you know, their arts to society and give them the platform to create. I mean, we're not just teaching, you know, the arts or honing their skills that they may already have, but we're literally teaching health and wellness. We're teaching business classes, how to create your own businesses, how to give back to the community. You know, we have mandatory community give back hours, teaching them to be a pillar in the community and you know, give back to society through their arts. So, yeah.
Wow. I wanted to make a correction. February 21st was Malcolm X. I may have slipped and said Martin Luther King. We've lost so many. And it was Malcolm X, of course, that we lost. We recognize his loss, but also his gifts. that he left behind and the legacy that we have as we pick up the torch and carry the baton. And so I would like to actually give the torch to Jibari. He's joining us and he works with youth that will say in under-resourced communities in the traditional sense, but definitely well-resourced in terms of the cultural heritage and cultural wealth that we champion, even if it's only amongst ourselves, we recognize it. So Jibari, would you like to join us and share with us what you're thinking?
Yeah, so first of all, I work with Teamwork Inglewood, a nonprofit organization. I work in the Department of Services and Public Safety, and I've been doing this work for 20 something years. I don't know if you all read my bio, but if you have read the bio, there's a connection with my background and the reason why I do this work. But I want to just talk about the film and the name Word Warriors. Like, I really would like to know more about the choosing of that term or that title, and how. So looking at the film, I was making a connection with our lineage keepers, like Dr. Martin Luther King, Malcolm X, and all of those great orators that we have had traditionally, and how they really like was the keepers of stories and you know, passing on information that's relevant to us surviving the societal obstacles that, you know, we have. So, you know, with the new hip hop and the disconnection there, like I was trying to find more of like how to come more with some solutions, you know, as how to connect the youth of today with hip hop and, you know, and with their heritage in the past. So I you know, that's what I wanted to ask the director.
Okay. I mean, yeah, you had a couple of questions. So the first one, the name, you know, we look at what we're going through as if we're in a war, you know, and because we're using words as our weapons, because words are so powerful, you know, words can literally create life or create death, you know. So that's where the name came from. And the three represents, it's a play on words. It's an exponent. So it's really word warriors to the third power, you know. As a poet, I'm a poet myself. So as a poet and having poetry be the foundation of this film, it was really important to let people know how powerful words are, and the poets in the film to actually, you know, perform their poetry as, like I said, and use it as weapons in everything that we're dealing with, and all the oppression, and, you know, it's our way to release, it's our way to express ourselves. But again, just the words that comes out of the mouths of all of the poets has made change. You know, it's touched someone, or it's helped someone, you know, get through situations or deal with certain experiences, or inspire them to do their own poem, or, you know, create their own art. So that's where the word, that's where the name was inspired by. I'm sorry, what was the other question?
No, you pretty much answered, but I think about a biblical verse that it says life and death is in the power of the tongue.
Yes.
You know, so with this word weaponry or the word weapon, I'm, you know, in the film, you alluded a lot to like systemic things that's happening. You know, a lot of the artists, a lot of the speakers talked about, you know, the systemic reason for a lot of these illnesses that affects our people. Mm-hmm. So, you know, this is a good platform, you know, enhancing or to see how can we enhance our words and our stories, you know, whatever form, be it storytelling, be it text, be it books, be it poetry, how can we enhance it to pass it on or to equip the next generation to carry on the torch, so to speak. So I think it was a good film. I also, you know, would like to see how can we carry this on to get the younger generation or this next generation to really embrace it and identify and understand, like, hey, this is actually a war. And words is playing a powerful part of this here through hip hop, through rap. You know, you mentioned NWA and all of those artists back in the back in the 80s, and how they was real influential in creating a trajectory of the movement. And then all of a sudden we saw the gangster rap and all of these negative images being projected upon us. So, it, you know, and that speaks to the seriousness of like how important our words are, because the enemy, you know, sees this and, you know, they monopolize on it and derail the conscious and the powerful moving forward of our people. So I think it's definitely an arena that we need to put a lot of focus on.
Yeah, I mean, music is one of the most powerful languages in the universe, is the most powerful language outside of love. But that's why, you know, it was important for me to start my youth center, because that is a way for me to connect with the youth, to be able to, like I said, we're instilling, first of all, we're helping them heal any of their trauma, you know. That's a part of the program where when we talk about health and wellness, you know, mental health is very important. And once they learn to love themselves and understand where they came from by seeing movies like this, or by listening to, you know, old songs that meant something, songs of movement is what I like to call it, then they will be inspired to create songs like that as well, or they will be inspired to create films and TV shows and podcasts and whatever they do, whether they're DJs, whatever they do in the entertainment world, you know, that's the seed I'm planting in any youth that come through my program. And, you know, we're starting in LA, but our goal as a board is to branch off into multiple cities, like the Boys and Girls Club, and literally be in every city implementing our program. And that's how it changes. I mean, it changes by us taking time out with the youth and listening to them, you know, having conversations with them about, you know, what's important to them. They're so smart. They see straight through the BS. You can't pull wool over their eyes, you know, and most of them are just hurting from something, you know. So once that hurt is healed, then they'll be able to tap into their power and use their words, you know, to create a new reality. Definitely. Because that's pretty much what happened with hip hop. You know, the reality was, you know, when we had Public Enemy and, you know, groups like that, when Queen Latifah back in the day, KRS-One, it's like the words that they spoke created a militant reality and it had us tapping into our power of who we are. And that, you know, it wasn't going well to be able to control our minds.
Yes.
And so what happened was there was a change, you know, and only certain types of artists who were putting out, you know, things to dumb us down or to diminish our power were the only ones getting signed and getting media attention. And so what that did was that changed the energy. And because music is so powerful and it is the most powerful language in the universe, and people globally are rapping lyrics that they don't even understand the English language, but they know how to rap an English song. you know, they're it's changing the energy of the world. It's changing the energy of the planet. And unless we change that energy back, we're going to continue to watch everything look like death around us, because that's what this music is speaking. It's speaking death. It's not speaking life. It's not speaking love. You know, it's coming from a place of trauma and of trauma that doesn't know how to be dealt with. So it's coming across as anger and sadness. And, you know, we need stuff that's, yes, we go through trauma and we can talk about that in our lyrics, but how do we get up out of that? How, you know, how do we inspire people to, you know, use their words to you know, help others to get out of something that they may have gone through or that they may be going through? And that's what's going to change. Compassion, empathy. We need that back in our music. And music, sometimes it's not a word. Music is energy. So that's why jazz was so important and powerful, because we felt the musician's energy through that instrument, you know? So it's gonna change, everything is gonna change when we change ourselves first. And that's where it starts. And it starts in the home and then the community.
So may I ask, would there be another part to this film? Because, you know, my take on it was real poignant. Mm-hmm. You know, you just spoke about, you know, passion, compassion, and those attributes that we're lacking as a people, as a movement. So, you know, I did, that's what I was hoping to see at the end of the film, more of speaking more to that. I know you know, it was realistic, you know, but it was very poignant. The absentee father piece was something that really hit home to me and a lot of the young people that I work with. You know, that's something that a lot of us have in common, you know, and to hear those poets speak to that, you know, was like, oh, it reminds me of reading the autobiography of Malcolm X and my similarity with his lifestyle. And I remember, you know, me being incarcerated, and when I got incarcerated, I read the autobiography of Malcolm X, and I remember him saying, wasn't nobody there but just us. And when I was incarcerated, I looked around and I saw a lot of people from my neighborhood, from the grammar school, from the high school, that I didn't ever know what happened to them, and they was there. Yes.
So. Yeah, I mean, that's where a lot of the hurt starts, is with the fathers being absent in the home. I mean, it was poignant to me because my father was incarcerated, and which caused me not to be able to grow up with him like that, which caused the root of some of my pain, you know, and you know, to answer your question, yes, I do want to do something else. I've been getting asked to do one for women, from the perspective of women. And also, you know, I want to work on something that's very, very, very important and of our community, and that's the crab in the barrel mentality. You know, but the most important thing is working on our trauma and our pain, and those young men that you're working with, and even the young men in the prison system. It's important for them to get one-on-one. Like, they just want to be heard, you know? And most of the time, everybody has a story. And that's what I'm saying. If you listen to an individual story and you show them compassion and empathy, and you're coming from a pure, genuine place, that just them venting and getting it out is the first step. Because that way, now they get to work on themselves, see why they act the way they act, why they make the decisions, the decisions that they make, the choices that they make, and see that it all stems from trauma. And it gives them an opportunity to tap into their power. Once we tap into our power individually, then we become the example of the next. And that will eliminate the crab in the barrel mentality. And we'll see that it's more than enough for everybody, because having the crab in the barrel mentality in our community is holding us back so much. We can't work together. We can't live together. We can't create businesses together. It's changing now with these young folks. And I love to see it with like the Earn Your Leisure guys and stuff like that, teaching people how to do stocks and make money. They're not hiding the knowledge. You know, we've been taught to hide knowledge and, oh, I'm just going to look out for myself. Well, that comes from the slave mentality.
Yes.
You know, and so once we tap into our power and know who we are, we don't have to walk around, you know, holding on like this all we got. I don't want to give it up. No, with us sharing with each other, the unity is what creates the power in our community, you know?
That's definitely a good point. This idea that you mentioned that we do want to have amplify the voices of young people. However, I think we need to consider the fact that once they've had a chance to vent or to share, we need to talk about the structures that we have in place so that we can equip them to be empowered. And critical youth empowerment, that means looking at what's happening and understanding that the music that shapes a narrative that benefits a larger structure. So right. I think we have to have children understand there's a reason why fathers were put in situations and many times where they were not able to be in the home because of the destruction of the Black family unit was very deliberate. Just in the same way mass incarceration, which you talked about in the film, was very deliberate. It's a form of social control. And it's an extension of slavery, which shifted, you know, to penal colonies. So this is all part of a grand design, which is what Dr. Omar Johnson noted earlier in the film. So we need to teach our youth, which is what Paulo Freire was saying, to read the world, to have that critical literacy, to ask the questions, why? And to look at the issue of social justice. What is the social justice component? Right now I'm sitting in ACUA, the self-determination center that's located in San Jose, California. And what they do is they make sure that the young people are grounded in their history, but also in understanding the realities of the world as children of African descent. And so there is responsibility we have within our community, but there's also a wider there has to be a wider recognition of the context in which we operate and who benefits from limiting our futures, limiting our hope. And we can essentially have that understanding and understanding there is what George Group talks about as post-traumatic slavery disorder. And it's post, but doesn't mean that it's present forever. And if that trauma is in our bodies, because the body holds a score, as the book says, the trauma becomes a part of our reality, then how do we move from that trauma to transformation, which is, I think, what you were saying. Yes. And the moments that we have left, and I appreciate you, Jibari, for mentioning the fact that you wanted the film to end a little bit differently. And I was looking for that, too. I was looking for circling back around to the part of us that is resilience. But I think that's where this next steps come in. And I think that's what you're talking about, moving on to different works where we can highlight ourselves. Because there's a quote that I saw in the Civil Rights Museum in the National Civil Rights Museum in Memphis, Tennessee, where it says, "We are beautiful if only to ourselves." And I think that's just a powerful reminder for us. This is an amazing conversation. We are going to highlight the March 20th event, which will be, to your point, actually looking at the fifth point on the Black Panther Party platform, their idea that we want education that is liberatory and education that tells the reality of where we are in the present day and in this society. And so we will have Sam Anderson, we will have Rosemary Mealy. Hopefully we'll have Mamut Naruhu, who is the founder and one of the co-directors of the center where we're in. And we will also have some other noted speakers who will be able to talk about the 1963 boycott that took place in Chicago schools and the fight to be able to keep our schools our own within our community. So last 2 seconds, if you have something to say, and if not, I would like to end with a quote by Umar Johnson. So Jabari, Tizzi.
Look, this film was done to spark the conversation. So I think it's doing its job right now, and we got a lot of work to do. And let's just continue to keep pushing forward with, you know, what we're doing in our communities.
Right. As they say, as the old folks say, our hands are full. Our hands are full. Jabari, a last moment for you before we give that quote that will hopefully will stay in people's minds.
Well, I'm just going to say that in our hands, we hold the key to our own liberation.
The quote that I'm referring to, thank you, Jabari, thank you, Tizzi. The quote that I'm referring to is when Umar Johnson said, education is the most powerful revolutionary process in any society. Education is the most powerful, is the most revolutionary process in any society. And that's what we've been talking about this last year as we celebrate the 100th birth of Paulo Freire, as we celebrate the 60th anniversary of the 1961 Cuban literacy campaign, where nearly 1 million people were taught how to read, write, and have literacy in terms of the environment, political literacy, health literacy. So this was a year of a number of milestones, 2021, 2022, and next month, we will wrap up the Paulo Freire do-it-yourself experience. And we're looking forward to you joining us on March 20th at 7 p.m. Central Time. And again, thank you to the director, the producer, the narrator, the film score, the film producer of this movie that has generated conversation. And you started in 2012. You finished it in 2016. It started making its rounds, and then in 2020 got picked up, and it will continue, I'm sure, to spark conversation for years to come. So thank you for being with us today, Ms. Green.
Thank you for having me.
Sure. And also Jabari Tidmore, keep doing the work, my brother.
And it was done 2012, June the 19th.
No, it was done in 2012. We started shooting in 2012, but it got released worldwide digital distribution on Juneteenth, 2020.
Juneteenth, 2020.
Yeah, June 20th, 2020. I mean, I'm sorry, June 19th, 2020.
That's very significant, right?
Yeah, I had no idea that was going to be the release date. And it was crazy because all the George Floyd, you know, stuff was going on, all the marching and, you know, and when I got the call, I didn't even realize when they say, yeah, the release date is June 19th. It didn't dawn on me until like a few minutes later, like that's Juneteenth. That's and perfect that's my, timing. And
that's my birthday.
See, there you go. Yeah.
Thank you.
Good day.
Yes.
Good day. Jabari, we'll let you wrap it up because this is a story in many ways about the Black community, but centering on Black men. So I think it's very apropos for us to end with the words of a powerful brother.
You know, the fact that, you know, we have this issue of Black men in endangered species or targeted, you know, we as men and women really have to put a lot of energy, a lot of focus on what can we do to reach the Black male. And I'm just gonna think about, you know, this recruitment of the Black Panther Party when they was building their movement. And I heard that they put a lot of emphasis on recruiting the sisters. And once the sisters came into the party, the brothers was able to come and they were like, look at these sisters with the Tams on, the Afros, the, you know, the leather jackets. Hey, I'm curious. So they left the corners to go see what was going on inside the offices and headquarters of the party and seeing these sisters. So that was a carrot to, you know, so I'm just mentioning that to say that sisters, brothers like myself that's mentors, we have to be real intentional about reaching our young people, going into the trap houses. Some of us, like myself, I'm brave enough to do, going and build studios. I hope that your studio in, I mean, your youth center in California has a studio. Here at Teamwork Inglewood, we just got an annex building, an OCPS building, and we hope to have a studio put there. So that way we, you know, we meet them where they are, but bring them in and get them where we need them to be. So that's our mission.
Absolutely. And I would love to connect with you and have some of your students, you know, because we're virtual right now, so they can get right on anywhere and then eventually, you know, do some stuff together. I'll come to Chicago.
You're more than welcome.
I'm not scared of the Chi Town.
Are you from what part?
I love my folks.
Spike Lee, I ain't gonna go into that movie he made. Direct stuff, but anyway.
It's all about connections. Thank you, Jabari, for giving us the last word. Thank you for those of us who joined us tonight from every state in the union and perhaps even outside, because definitely this is a worldwide issue. What do we do to have caring, to have empathy, and to have courage to make this world a better place? So see you on March the 20th, 7 p.m.
All right. Great.
Paulo Freire é educação. Pensar transforma, muda, é abolição. Freiriana é sua missão. Pensar transforma, muda, é evolução. O conhecimento liberta, vamos transformar. Educar o mundo de dentro pra fora, interpretar. Mundo líquido, monolítico. A solução é alfabetizar, é reinventar. Me dê a mão e vamos para a luta já. Braços abertos à felicidade encontrar. De braços dados vamos ao outro ajudar. Paulo, pernambucano, franzino, valente, homem de bem,